tell you about the Mark of the Beast and the Antichrist real quick. Okay, Mark of the Beast is going to be a global world system that you won't be able to participate in unless you reject Jesus Christ. This system, you won't be able to buy, trade, or sell unless you have the Mark of the Beast. And then if you don't become a part of it, they'll kill you and your family and all that stuff. So one thing about the Mark of the Beast is they have this chip called the RFID chip, which is Radio Frequency ID chip. The Lord identified through his prophets that is the Mark of the Beast, and you can't accept it. You can't let them implant it in you. No, don't let them put it in you as a tattoo. Don't ingest it, and don't let them implant it in your right hand. Like the Bible says in Revelation, said no man will buy, trade, or sell without the mark. And then they get the mark of the beast in their right hand and in their forehead. That's what the word of God says. And it says that any man that takes the mark of the beast, you're going to come down with these grievous sores. And also, God's not going to let you into heaven, because that's the ultimate form of treason. This RFID chip, it's a GMO, so if you take it, it's going to kill you. Eventually, the chip is going to kill you itself, and so you'll lose your life. And on top of that, you'll lose your soul. So the Antichrist, he's going to be a flesh man that's going to come on the scene, and he's going to be having supernatural powers that he gets from the devil. And he's going to be able to do miracles right in front of you. And so he's going to go into the temple over there in Jerusalem and pretend to be God. And all that stuff like that. So this guy, I mean, when he comes on the scene, he's going to be a smooth talker. Everybody's going to be in love with him, because at first he's going to be uniting all the religions and bringing about world peace and all that stuff. And then the aliens, the UFOs, which are really demons posing as aliens, are going to come down and confirm him. Like, yeah, this is the guy and this is God and we're on God's side and all this bunch of nonsense. Let me tell you how the real God comes back. When Jesus Christ returns back, he ain't doing world peace. He's coming back as a conqueror. And he first thing he does, he burns up his enemies with fire that comes out of his mouth from the word. His word sets people on fire. The word coming from Jesus cuts like a sword and devours up all his enemies. And people that's all underground, those Satanists, they're going to be trying to hide out and all that stuff. And they ain't going to be able to hide out, because they're going to see him coming even through the rock. So he's going to make sure of that. So that's how the real Jesus Christ comes back. He comes back as a God. A God that's putting fire on his enemies. It won't be no mistakes. But before that, there's going to be false Christ and rising up. Like fake Jesus Christ. And then the Satanists and all these enemies are going to be saying, yeah, we got Jesus in the secret place. Come with us and we're going to show you Jesus. And all that stuff. It's going to be fake. But the real Jesus, ain't nobody got to go show you the real Jesus, because when he comes, every eye is going to see him at the same time. So there's no mistake. That's the most grand entrance there is. So don't fall for any of that other stuff. Don't fall for the Antichrist pretending to be God, because he got a little bit of powers that he got from the devil and technology, because they with Project Bluebeam, they can make holograms of any religious figure that you want to think of just to fool you. So don't fall for any of that stuff. If they tell you can't eat and we're going to kill your children or we're going to do all this and that, hey, you still can't deny Jesus. You got to hang on to Jesus no matter what, because guess what? Jesus Christ died for us. You know, he took our penalty on the cross. You know, where all of us have sinned and was worthy of you know, the ultimate punishment. But Jesus said, hey, I'll take their punishment for them. He said that to the Father. So he took our place on the cross so that we can have a chance to live with God and Jesus in heaven. So we can't wimp out and we can't deny him just so we can eat food or feed our family or save our own lives. You know, that's a coward move. So we can't do that. And if you do that, it's unforgivable. And don't think you're going to take the mark of the beast and then try to cut it off you later on and stuff, because that thing ties into your nervous system. So once you have it, they can pretty much control you. You know what I mean? So if you have it, it's it. It's a wrap. You know what I mean? And then they can control you just like a robot. You won't be able to repent. And if you ain't doing what they said, they can send a signal to that chip and it'll cause you great pain in your body. So do not take the RFID chip. Do not take the mark of the beast. Hang on to Jesus with all you got. And don't fall for no fake Jesuses, no false Jesus. Because Jesus ain't going to come back as no flesh man and be hiding out in some secret place or some flesh Jesus, somebody walking around. No. When the real Jesus Christ come back, he come back as God. And the first thing he's doing is burning up his enemies. He came peaceful the first time. And what did they do to him? They killed him. They murdered him. They were jealous of him. You know what I mean? So this stuff is getting pretty serious, all right? So I'll tell you about the Noahide laws. The Noahide laws put teeth behind the Mark of the Beast system. Because the Noahide laws came from the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin is the same punks that killed Jesus back in his day. Those losers. They murdered Jesus because they was jealous of him. Because Jesus was doing a good thing. He wasn't doing all that fake religion like you see in these fake churches now. That's all Joel Osteen kind of churches. You know, just garbage. You know, just not even preaching the word. Just telling you what you want to hear. Not preaching against sin. Just being losers. So, nah. Jesus came with the real word back then. And they hated him. And all those losers, they killed him. So today the Sanhedrin came with this thing called the Noahide laws. The Noahide laws is a bunch of laws. They sound like they make sense at first, but when you dig deep into it, one of the things about it is if the worship of Jesus Christ to the Noahide laws is considered idolatry, punishable by death. So that's how they'll be able to threaten you. And all that stuff gonna work with this fake religious holy Joe called the Antichrist. When the real Christ comes back, he's going to burn that sucker up. And then all those world powers is trying to fight against Jesus Christ, like he's a bad alien or something, he's going to wipe them out. He's going to mop the floor with them. You know what I mean? So, let's tell you, man, aliens and all that stuff, it's all local. They're not from faraway planets and all that. That's a bunch of garbage. Everything, we are in a closed system. Everything, the planets are all within the Earth. The Earth is the biggest. The Earth is bigger than the sun, the moon, and everything. The Earth is the biggest thing. The Earth is bigger than the planets. Everything, God set up everything around the world, the Earth. Everything is set up around the Earth like a clock. The whole system is a closed system, and it runs like a clock. So ain't no aliens from faraway galaxies coming here and talking about they created us and all this garbage. They're fallen angels, when they had sex with human women, they caused giants to be in the earth. And when the giants died, their spirits roamed the world as demons. This is what the demons come from. So these little fake alien, light bulb head looking losers with the big black eyes, they're creating them down there in labs. You know, so they can have a body. All that body is an interface for demons. And a demon controls that thing. And then down there in the underground bases, they got species that they're creating. Mixing animal and human hybrids, and they're gonna bring them out and say, these are aliens from other worlds. They're from other planets and all this junk. And they're making them underground. You know what I mean? They ain't from faraway galaxies. That's just to bring that out to fool you. That's why they give you all these movies, Avatar and all this garbage, and all this aliens, light bulb head dudes, stealing people and kidnapping people in the saucers and all that stuff. So the people that's being taking on the saucers and all that crap, all this anti-gravity crafts that we can make. Anyway, when they get taken on the craft and they see that they're going up, they never go into outer space. They always go up and they go down under the water in the ocean, or they go underground. So that's letting you know that whole thing with the aliens is local. It's all local. It ain't far away. And none of that. Okay? So just letting you know what time it is, so you won't be fooled and all this stuff like this. So just get ready and just hang on to Christ with all you got. Learn that Bible, because the Word of God has power against demons. You know what I mean? The demons can't do anything without permission. They have to get permission either from you, from your sins, or from God. And the only reason they want you to send the demons is so they can attack you. You know, you get tattoos on your body. That's an interface. That's an attack point for demons. Demons can attack. That's why they want you to get tattoos. So you ain't supposed to get tattoos according to the Word of God. You know what I mean? So all this stuff is knowledge for you. And let all these things that I'm telling you right now, let it be a blessing to you. Let it be seeds that spring up later. So you won't be fooled when some smooth talker giving it. They're going to bring out cures. Okay, let's check this out. They're going to bring out cures and give this Antichrist dude the credit. Like he came up with it, or like the fallen angels, all these aliens, like they came up with it. Listen, it's human beings right now making cures for everything, left and right. And so the Satanists come up, they show up, they give these people money, and then they take these cures and hide them and shelve them. Or they murder the people that won't sell out. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. So it's all a big old plan. It's just a big old plan. And they've been planning it out forever. So there's big battles on right now. The patriots and the good guys and God's forces against the Satanists. You know what I mean? So that's what's going on right now in the world. So just learn Psalm 91, be able to say it in the face of the enemy. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love God with all you got, because he died for you. He gave up everything for you. He was so serious about you, his love for you, that he left his throne. The king left his throne and died for his people just to give you a chance to go into heaven to live with him. What other king done that? What other so-called God did that? None of them. They either want you to kill for them or something like that. But our God died for us. That's big. That's huge. You know what I mean? That's the real deal right there. That's the God I serve. And this God is about love your neighbor as you love yourself. Bless those that curse you. Pray for your enemies. Come on now. Come on now. So that's the real deal right there. It's all about love. If you ain't got love, true love, you ain't got nothing. You know what I mean? And God, you know what he did? He made Adam and Eve. He didn't make Adam and Steve. You know what I mean? So anything that's you're feeling like you want to be a woman and you're a man, or you're a man, you want to be a woman. Don't you know that they put stuff in the soil to make you feel that way? Chemicals on purpose. I think it's one's called atrazine, and they spread it on all the crops. And this chemical, it causes male frogs to produce eggs and ovaries and wanna be with other male frogs. And in males, human males, it makes your body produce estrogen. So this is why you're born feeling this way. It was all done on purpose. It was all done on purpose. But guess what? We love y'all. You know what I'm saying? Just letting you know what's going on. So you got to repent. Repent of what you're doing, and just ask God to heal you. And just know what's being done to you. These things are being done to you on purpose. And that's why you're feeling that way. Because the reason that they want to promote that stuff anyway is because they're trying to reduce the population. They want to play God. They think they're God. They don't want to listen to God and his word, the Bible. But they want to play God themselves. See what I mean? They're hypocrites. And they get to decide who lives and dies. They got this stuff, the Georgia Guidestones. They got all this stuff written on the Georgia Guidestones. Oh, we got to keep the population down to less than a billion or whatever it is. So what? They the ones that get to live? How do they get to decide that they are worthy to live and all the rest of us? They look at us as weeds and stuff like that. So look, that's the enemy side. So you got to get with it, get right, get on God's side, get on God's team side. And that's the Jesus Christ team side. Read that King James Bible, baby. Because that's what he gave you instructions on how to make it to heaven. You know what I mean? Follow the four gospels. Christ showed you what to do in the four gospels. You know what I mean? People say, oh, Christianity killed this and that. No, he didn't. Catholics did that back in them days. The Catholics came along and they was killing anybody that wouldn't convert to them. And they were killing us if they caught us reading the Bible. They didn't want us to read the Bible. They wanted us to follow their nonsense and their traditions. You know what I mean? I'm talking about back then, the ones that was killing us. I'm not talking about the Catholics today that believe in Jesus, you know what I mean? Because many of them are going to be in heaven. But you got to know your history and stuff like that. And you got to know what happened. When you follow somebody, you want to call yourself a Christian, you follow somebody, that means you follow the teachings of your leader. Jesus Christ is our leader and our Lord. What did he teach? He didn't teach killing. Him and his disciples, they didn't kill not one person. Not one person. Okay? So it says, thou shalt not kill. What that means is, thou shalt not murder. That's what that means. It don't mean thou shalt not kill. It means thou shalt not murder. So self-defense, you know, you have to do what you got to do. You know what I mean? You know, God didn't make you as a doormat. But you got to use common sense. You got to use discernment. And you got to use love. And you got to use mercy. You know what I mean? You're not going to let somebody run up in your house and harm and rape your family. You're going to defend at all costs. You know what I mean? And that's what that means. You know? So just got to use common sense, people, you know, and, you know, y'all have it, just use it, you know, we all got it, we all got gifts, we all got talent, so I just want you guys to know that I love y'all. Don't be offended with me, because I'm telling you this because I love you. If I didn't love you, I wouldn't tell you nothing, you know what I mean, because I don't like all that static and, oh, somebody getting mad because I told them something that's trying to help them. Nah, you know, if I didn't care, because of that, I wouldn't tell you anything and let you just go ahead on and just worry about myself and just worry about me going to heaven. It's to say, forget y'all because y'all too hard-headed and y'all fuss back too much. So no, I ain't worried about all that. I'm going to tell you anyway, and that's true love. Well, I'll put up with whatever you throw my way because that's true love, just to tell you the truth, just so you can have a chance in heaven. Well, you can see me in heaven, shake my hand, and say, thank you, Brother Eric. Thank you for telling me that stuff, man. You know, you made me mad at first, but hey, I'm here in heaven right now because what you said planted a seed in me, and I thought about it, and boom, here I am. Thank you, brother. So that's That's what I want to see in the end right there. You know what I mean? So don't be getting mad and all that stuff. Just, hey, look at the word, man. You know, listen, the devil controls information, okay? He controls the information. I mean, think about it. Right there in the Bible, it says the devil took Jesus up to a high mountain and showed him all the kings of the world, all the kingdoms of the world, and told Jesus, say, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you all them kingdoms, okay? So that means that Satan hijacked them kingdoms, and that's how he offered it to Jesus. You know what I mean? He's trying to tempt Jesus with those kingdoms that he hijacked. You know, so he controls information. So that's why they're teaching you nonsense in school. Everything they try to teach you in school is against the Bible, because these enemies, these devils, they want you to die. They want you to go to hell with them. You know, the demons, they already condemned and they just want company. That's what it's all about. Satan just wants company. So that's why everything that's being taught is to go against the Bible, so you won't have a chance. That's what it is. You got to wake up and see what the game is. That's the game right there in a nutshell. I'm going to break it down for you, okay? So that's what's going on, people. All right? God bless y'all. Hugs and kisses from Jesus and all that good stuff like that. And peace.
Bible prophecy warns of a flesh man coming on the scene with supernatural powers that he got from the devil. Well, he will use these supernatural powers to do miracles in the sight of men, and these miracles he will use to fool the entire world into thinking that he's God or Jesus Christ, or try to replace Christ. Let me tell you about the mark of the beast and the Antichrist real quick. The Antichrist is going to be somebody that's going to be 100 times worse than Hitler. But when he starts out, he's going to be a beautiful speaker, mesmerizing in appearance, and a man of peace. That's how he's going to present himself. And he's going to unite all the world's religions under him. And he's going to pretty much form a religious dictatorship that will kill anybody that doesn't bow down to him. First on his list will be to kill Christians, to take the place of Jesus Christ, and to claim that he's God. He's going to sit in the temple over in Jerusalem and pretend to be God. Well, his system is going to be financial, economic, and all that. And you won't be able to be a part of that system unless you take an oath to him and reject all your former faiths like Christianity and whatever else you believed in. And if you ain't willing to do that, he'll threaten your family and threaten your kids and threaten your mom to kill them first in front of you and then kill you. But if you're a Christian, you know that you got to stick with Christ no matter what, even if it means death, because Christ died for us. He gave us his all, you know, just so we could have a chance to live with him in heaven. So this Mark of the Beast and Antichrist, it has teeth behind it, because in 1991, these laws were introduced to the U.S. from the Sanhedrin called the Noahide Laws, and it's 7 of them. But as you go deeper into these Noahide Laws, one of the tenets is, if you will not renounce Jesus Christ, the penalty is death, because worshiping Jesus Christ to the Sanhedrin and the Noahide laws is considered idolatry. And so they'll murder you. The Sanhedrin is the same guys back in the Bible days that conspired against and murdered Jesus, because they were jealous of Jesus, because Jesus was like an innovator, you know, where they was all about that religion and exploiting people. But Jesus Christ came with the true faith, which was a family-based doctrine, where you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ is the Son. He's our Redeemer, he's our Healer, he's our everything, and he came to earth from heaven to show us how to do it. And the difference between him and all these other false gods is Jesus Christ is the only God that said he wasn't too good to die for his servants. So he left his throne in heaven and came down here and died, took our penalty on the cross, because we were sinners and we were worthy of whatever punishment we were supposed to get by the bad things we've done. But Christ said, you know what, Father, I'll take their punishment for them. And if they follow me, I'll lead them to heaven. So leave them in my hands. So Christ is like our lawyer, our defender, our everything, because Satan, all he does is accuse us of all the bad things we do. He's like, hey God, look at what they're doing. They're just like me, so I get to take them into hell. But Christ said, hey, if they follow me, my blood is on them, so they're mine, and I can take them with me to heaven. So that's what the deal is with Jesus Christ and this Mark of the Beast and Antichrist system. This Antichrist figure, he's going to have supernatural powers, and all that. He's going to have everything that he needs from the devil to fool mankind. But just know, if you're a Christian, you can't go along with him just to save your life or to eat or anything like that. Because if you do, God will reject you and you won't be able to go to heaven. So you have to hold on no matter how hard it gets. So it's letting everybody know about the Antichrist and the beast system. All right, guys, make the right choice. God bless you, and I love you. Yeah, I received an update today on the Mark of the Beast, and from a prophet of God, and she was telling me about the Lord was letting her know about the RFID chip, that goes in conjunction with the Mark of the Beast. Do not take it. Do not let them inject you with it. Do not let them give it to you as a tattoo. And do not ingest it, like taking it like a tablet, orally. Don't take it at all, because taking the mark of the beast is unforgivable by God. He will not forgive you at all if you take the mark of the beast. And also that RFID chip, it is a GMO. So once it's in you, it's also going to kill you. And then on top of that, you lose your soul too, to hell. So have nothing to do with RFID chip. I don't care how much convenience they tell you it's going to be and all this. Just don't take it. All right, people. God bless. I'm going to read from the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write these things, saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee, because thou hast kept the word of my patience. I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world, to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Okay, I'm reading from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and this relates to the Antichrist topic. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivable and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, and that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. Wherefore, whereunto he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, stand fast, hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and God, even our Father, which hath loved us, and have given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work.
I do have to admit, I like it when it all comes together. When the top part, catching the football, right, whether you're catching it with your hands or cradling it, 46. Comes together with the legs, in this case, the feet, doing a little toe tap to stay in bounds and complete the catch.
And a great job by our crew on the camera shot. Love when you see the grass or on the field turf, those rubber pellets flying up. Great catch. He'll get it up the middle, and he gets halfway there, down to the 1 yard line. Only a yard that time, second and goal. Under four to go now as the clock runs and they come up on second down. They'll try and sneak it here, and he'll get in. Touchdown, Cowboys. Mike White scoring on the sneak from a yard out, and the Cowboys will add on to their lead. And now Jason Garrett electing for his guys to try for two. Now a toss coming right side. That's Jackson. And he is into the end zone to bump the lead up two more. Now to kick this one away, and off it goes. Now it's Patterson. Oh, a little 360. Oh, Cordarrelle Patterson, past the 20. And all the way in. Touchdown, New England. Cordarrelle Patterson taking it goal line to goal line, 100 yards. And the Patriots have cut it back within a score. Gostkowski for the point after. Gostkowski with the extra point. And the lead is down to two. So now the other return teams out there, as they'll try to duplicate what they just saw. The offense for the Cowboys now working their way back onto the field. And right now they're saying, hey, let's keep this going. Two drives, two touchdowns.
Yeah, can't ask for a better start than that, can you? I mean, this is the way you practice it. This is the way you rehearse it. But right now, the play calling, they're locked in really well.
So Prescott and the Cowboys now with a first and 10 at their 25-yard line. Play and it'll be second down. Well, they had to run for no gain. Now they'll try again from the 25 on second and 10. Second down, Prescott being chased out left. And he's just going to get rid of this thing to no one here. He throws it away, and now it's third. They got pressure there and only rushing three.
And there's a defensive coordinator right now who is celebrating not just getting home with three there, but realizing if that's the type of pressure he can get in the entire game, then his pass defense is going to be excellent. You're dropping eight. Where are you going to go with the football?
86.
On third down, it's Prescott. And they're able to get this one across the 35. First catch for him. It's good for a dozen and a first down.
Ah, that's tough to play zone defense when they can just curl up right there in front of you.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we talk about finding the soft spot defensively. How do you make sure they don't find the soft spot like they did there?
Tough to do, because what they normally will do is run routes that'll pull you out of that spot that they want to get into. That's what we call not taking the cheese, right? Don't go for the mousetrap. But it's hard to do, because when you see a guy cutting that in that direction, you tend to go towards him.
8 yards on the pickup, and now they'll have some options on second and short.
So 2 minutes to go in a wild first half. Back to Foxborough after this.
Now a carry for the big fella. This is Jermaine Olawale. And he'll take this one across the 45 up to about the 46-yard line. It'll be a gain of two on the play, but they'll remain a few inches short here with third down looming. They'll go with a keeper, and they will touch him down, but not before he gets the first. He'll wind up getting two there as he does it himself and picks up the first. A first down carry for Smith. And taking it across midfield and just shy of the 40. Give him 10 yards on that one, and that'll earn him a fresh set of downs.
Really strong, effective run there out of a power set or a heavy set. Three tight ends in the game, and that's tough for a defensive coordinator. They want to spot that lineup coming into the game early so they can get the proper defensive personnel on the field. That's why the coordinator's relying on some of the assistants to tell him what offensive personnel is hitting the field so he can adjust accordingly. They weren't able to stop him on that run.
They'll run with Elliott, and he'll take this one down to about the 40. Give him a couple on the carry there, second and 8.
Well, we saw him there trying to get it to the outside, trying to get to the perimeter, but not a whole lot of room there. But there's got to be one positive to that. If you keep moving laterally, creases tend to develop as the game moves on, and they can run it back inside later.
Prescott now escaping the pressure, and he's going to have to eat this one as down he goes. John Simon able to run him down for a loss of a yard.
The Cowboys on third down. A perfect 3-for-3 as they look to keep that streak going. This is 3rd and 9. Final play of the half. Prescott. He's going to loft one deep left side here. And incomplete on the deep ball. So we've hit intermission. It's halftime. This is the NFL, and it's a presentation of EA Sports. All right, Coach, thank you, and we welcome everyone back for quarter number 3. Both teams appear ready for the fight ahead, and we resume action here in quarter number 3. That'll be taken in the end zone. And good starting field position. He'll get this one all the way up to about the 35-yard line. Now the Patriot offense set to take over again. They're down here, but very much in this game. What's the tonality of a coach's talk when a game is within striking distance like this at intermission?
Typically, what they're doing is emphasizing the things that went well in the first half and wanting more of that. Sure, you've got to go over some of the errors and clean up some things because there's a reason you're down. But overall, I think they want to stay positive, stay up with this team. We're just starting the second half, and we've got the football. Let's go ahead and punch it in, and then we'll take it from there.
See how that recipe works. From midfield, here's Brady. And his pass incomplete. We have not seen a whole lot of wide open receivers. Everything seemingly has been contested.
And that's another nice job there to force an incompletion. They've been very cohesive, knowing each other's moves all game long, and they've been on the spot just about every time.
And they've held them in check on the scoreboard. Brady will try again on second down. And that one got tipped, kind of threw everything off. It brings up third.
Well, we're not playing 3 yards in the cloud of dust football anymore. I kind of get why those old school coaches sometimes didn't want to throw the football, because if it's popped up in the air, it almost turns into slow motion, and both sides trying to get to the football, and you're holding your breath wondering where it's going to go. Good.
This is intercepted. Picked off at about the 31. And the return stops just a little bit shy of midfield at the 48-yard line. Well, and I saw the pressure coming at him. That just looked problematic. Hit him as he threw it, and the interception ensued.
Let me pay homage to the man who stood in this spot before. He always talked about how much pressure is in the face of a guy, and can he step into a throw? And when you can't do that, oftentimes interceptions result.
So good starting field position for him here as they come up first and 10. Operating from the gun, Rush. It's complete to Brown, right side. He got 29 yards that time.
I know many people like to throw to the tight end, maybe in a little flexed out position because he creates mismatches with his size. But slot receivers do the same thing with their quickness, their speed, and their route running savvy.
So into Pat's territory now. Here's 1st and 10 at the 23. White. His throw caught at about the 5. And all the way down inside the 5 to the 4. 19 yards on the pickup there, and now they'll have it 1st and goal. Shotgun. Here's White. And he is going to go down. Back at the 11-yard line.
That's his second sack of the game. And the best defensive ends, they do their homework as much as offensive guys do. They know how to beat the offensive lineman across from them, what moves they need to do to set them up. This guy's been pretty good at it all game long.
White on 2nd down. Flushed out right. And he's going to be brought down just shy of the five at the six. He'll wind up with positive yardage. It's a gain of three. But now it's third down. The Cowboys on third down. They've been good. 3 for 4 thus far. They're looking at a third and goal here. Here's Prescott. Flush to his right. He can, and he will score. Touchdown, Cowboys. Dak Prescott, a 6-yard touchdown run. And the Cowboys will extend their lead. So a quarterback scramble, certainly a pass play, but he saw something, tucked it, and got in the end zone.
A lot of quarterbacks, when they scramble, they're scrambling to create more time to throw the ball downfield. In this situation, as you noted, he tucked it and took off. Great play by him.
And now Jason Garrett electing for his guys to try for two. They'll let Elliott try to run it in. And he will get into the end zone to extend the lead by two more. The kickoff unit is out on the field, and they will send this one away. This fielded a few yards into the end zone. Able to spin free. And the decision to bring it out, a good one, as he's up a yard or two shy of the 30. And now out come the Patriots. A tale of two extremes already in this game. A touchdown pass on their opening drive followed by an interception last time out.
Now, it sounds like things balance out, right? What's that mythological thing that we do? If you have a candy bar, have a diet soda with it, it balances it out. And we know that's not really true, right? Because the interception, that sting lingers a little bit longer. Got to come out now and put together some nice plays.
And he's way down into Dallas territory inside the Cowboy 15. It's a big play there for the Patriots. 59 yards. Into the red zone, it's Brady. And this will be incomplete.
All right, that one fell incomplete there, but the best quarterbacks, they'll miss on 40% of their throws somewhere in that neighborhood, similar to a great hitter in baseball who's going to fail 7 out of 10 times and still have a great year. In this case, you want perfection, but way better.
And he's going to get into the end zone. So cue up the Gronk spike, gets a Patriot touchdown. Rob Gronkowski from 13 yards out, and the Patriots are back within a score. The point after try for Gronkowski. Extra point, good by Gronkowski. And that cuts the lead to 3, 24-21. Boy, it's only a one-score game. Third quarter, mind you, but they're going to go for the onside kick right here. And the Cowboys are able to recover. I know they're down, but starting the third quarter there with the onside kick, what'd you think?
Well, I think that they're looking at it as we may not have as many possessions in this game as we want. There may be that sense and that feel that they've got to go ahead and make something happen, steal a possession, try and steal some points, and get themselves right back in a position to try and win the game.
A first down carry by Elliott. And able to push his way forward here for a good little game. Lawrence Guy able to bring him down.
An opportunity to get a drive started here at the end of the third quarter. What you're trying to do is break the game down a little bit. Don't let your guys see too deep into the game, into the future, and say, oh, we got to get here. No, right here, right in front of them, melt the clock down, get to the fourth quarter, try and keep going.
And try to keep that lead.
Exactly.
Again, it's Elliott. And the lane closes up quickly as he'll get about 3 down to the 38.
Partner, we know today's NFL is really built around the guy throwing the football. But these short runs, they still pay dividends because they can take their toll on a defense and they can add up as the game goes along. You control the clock, you control the ball, and that way you often control the game.
And he gets it to the 32, good enough for a first down. From the 32 now, here's first and 10. Down, it's White toward the sideline, and look at that catch, dragging the toes, and that's going to be a first down. Well done, and a nice gain of 21 yards. The give is to Elliott. He gets this down to the three, but no further. Brought the power run out of the bag and got a couple extra yards with it. Just what you want on a first down run. Call it 8 yards, and it's second and 2. Down to about the 2-yard line. Only a yard on the pickup, so from a good situation on second and 2, it's now 3rd and 1. They come out with one back and 3 tight ends. On 3rd and short, going with their tight end. And not going to be able to push this forward. He runs into a wall right at the line of scrimmage. Line of scrimmage, the 2. They can still get a first down if they just get a yard out of this on 4th and very short. Running with Elliott. And he will take it in for a Cowboy score. Ezekiel Elliott taking it in from 2 yards out. And the Cowboys will add on to their lead. And there you go. Nothing really too complex. Block, keep to your assignments, let them run it in. They did it.
Fundamental football. Good blocking beats good tackling on that play. End result, touchdown.
All right, so the Cowboys will go for 2 here. They're going to keep it on the ground. And he gets halfway there down to the 1-yard line.
Well, partner, since this new 2-point rule came into play, offense has spent a lot more time working on it. That means the defenses are doing the exact same thing.
Out is the kickoff unit as they run up and send this one away. Fielded about a yard deep. And he'll take it up past the 25 to the 26-yard line. The Patriots offense now, they work their way back onto the field. And for them, a touchdown their last go around. Obviously, they'll be hoping to do that again.
And when you start plotting for this drive, when you start thinking to yourself, okay, what are we going to do? You don't go away from what you did before because that worked, but you have to be prepared for wrinkles and counters because you know they'll make some adjustments.
Brady got a man complete. It's Chris Hogan. And he's able to take this one up to the 35-yard line. Give him 9 there on the first down completion. Those short little routes probably going to be open. The defense, they'll let those happen, especially when they can make an inbounds. And this is intercepted, and that should do it. Picked off right around the 43. And they are.
He's going to go for it.
Now Ben on third and long. And this throw will be intercepted. Picked off by Anthony Brown. And they will finally get him as he's all the way down near the 40-yard line. Well, and I saw the pressure coming at him. That just looked problematic. Hit him as he threw it, and the interception ensued.
Let me pay homage to the man who stood this spot for receivers to run through.
On third and goal, Roethlisberger. He rifles one that's intercepted. Picked off by the linebacker, Jalen Smith. And a big turnover there as his guys will get the football back. Certainly not how they envisioned it.